Sadly, 1993 was a year we said final farewells to many entertainment greats. We saw footlights fade on pioneers of the stage and silver screen. We mourned celebrities who used their fame to make this world a better place. And we said goodbye to some who died too young. They may be gone, but the memory of their work will live on in our hearts and minds.
If I had a normal family and a good upbringing, then I would have been a well-adjusted person.
River Phoenix's life ended on Halloween. The promising young actor collapsed and died outside a West Hollywood nightclub. Cause of death was a massive drug overdose. River Phoenix was only 23.
Here's something we never thought we'd report. River Phoenix has a new movie on the way. 19 years after his tragic death, the former teen heartthrob is headed back to the big screen. After his death, we learned that he was just 2 weeks away from completing a film called Dark Blood. Director George Sluzer promptly locked the unfinished footage away, figuring that the project was gone for good. Now, next month, Dark Blood will be screened for a special audience at the Dutch Film Festival.
7, eind 2000, kreeg ik een slagaderbreuk. Toen ben ik een jaar zeg maar, weg geweest. Dan moet je maar noemen, invalide, totaal in bed en operaties. En, in die tijd had ik zeg van, nou, ik wil eigenlijk... Want men gaf mij weinig tijd, laat ik het zo zeggen, ook toen al. Dat ik, ja, ik wil eigenlijk die film afmaken. De bronnen, ik noem het een creatief.
Anybody that dies close to you, it's always a shock. You know, if you're old or young, it's always too soon. So, and especially someone as vital as River was.
So this night is also honoring River Phoenix.
Yeah, I hope so. I'm sure it will.
Wake up and have people here.
I fitted carbon dust filters, complete air change every 6 hours, heating system in 2 chambers. They're my friends. Early bird gets the worm, eh?
Stop that.
Harry won't like it.
You're all alone out here. Attractive woman comes along, fluttering her eyelashes. Don't get too excited.
Hey, this is what it is with you, isn't it? Everything's a smart ass girl.
That's what you've been aiming for, isn't
it? No,
it
is not.
I'll kill you.
Come with me.
...2013 commemorates the 20th anniversary of the tragic death of River Phoenix. His death was one of the most shocking and mourned passings in Hollywood history. An event so unexpected, so sudden, made all the more painful by how he died. But this film is not about the death of River Phoenix. It is about his life, his passions, his extraordinary talent that continues to fascinate and intrigue. A life and talent that not only touched his own generation, but also a whole new generation who have discovered him in the years since his death. This film, too, is not a glorification of River, because he wasn't, nor ever intended to be, a martyr for the world. Like us all, he was a human being, a talented, gifted, perceptive soul, beset by sensitivity, inner turmoil, and questions that many of us experience. It was this humanity that endeared River to the world at large. His vulnerability and honesty were integral parts of his work as an actor. He had the ability to involve an audience in his characters you could relate and ultimately enjoy. He inspired people during his lifetime and continues to inspire to this day. Although his career would only span little over a decade, the 13 motion pictures, numerous television, and original music he created during his lifetime lives on. This film was a project that I began as a document for me alone, a blueprint for a documentary that I intend to make in the future. However, I was encouraged to share this work. By collating existing interviews, capturing audio overlaid by my own visual collage, and material from my own archives, I have sought to portray an honest, chronological account of River's life and legacy, to reassert his artistry that the mass media stripped of him following his death. It seeks to elevate River's life from the still-held unfair perception as a mere victim of drug abuse, and to re-establish his life as a talented artist who campaigned passionately for the environment, animal rights, and equality. It is a film that seeks humbly to remind the world that despite his death, River Phoenix was here.
He was the sensitive kid with the tough exterior in the movie Stand By Me. He was just 16, and he was in the spotlight. 2 years later, he would be nominated for an Oscar in Sidney Lumet's Running on Empty.
Aren't we supposed to question authority? You taught me that.
It was the story of a boy born into a non-conventional nomadic family, and River Phoenix traveled some common ground with his character. He, too, was born of non-conformist parents who encouraged him to be independent early on.
I have been encouraged to take responsible action in my life, and I have been since I was very young. All the kids, we're all, real extreme individuals, and very much we're all people.
Just 18, when in this interview he talked about life off the movie set, he said he would do things to remind himself of who he was, to play guitar, to do music.
Think, well, a lot of thinking, form relationships or redistribute my energy in different ways. I'm not on a set doing what I am used to doing, so, I have to learn to make that adjustment change it.
Talk then about the pressures of the business.
So I can give you in general superficial answer. Yeah, day to day, you have the things that rub you the wrong way, that rhyme sort of thing, and you deal with them, and once you do, then you begin to make things better. Hey, Jude.
River Phoenix was 23.
Sarah Joe. Going for a walk, having a talk, reflecting on the things that has taught us. We are all there, swimming in the same waters.
I don't think I ever felt that something was false or fakey. I'm quite sensitive, I guess, to people who are either theatrical in the wrong way or are just saying lines which they don't understand or don't mean, you know, they don't know. It has a lot to do with, you know, the pauses you make when you talk and how your voice goes and so on, and how, I would say, the body and the voice and the arms and the feet and everything and the eyes are in sync. Or one thing, when you think or feel one thing, you know, your feet should feel it too. You know, if you don't, then you're acting the wrong way. And so, and River, in that sense, was absolutely an actor, because I felt that his whole body was participating.
Did you go to an acting school?
No. No, I started acting through auditioning and trial by error, basically.
How old were you then when you started?
10.
Today's the day we're going to Grandpa's farm!
You should have a smooth flight all the way.
I hope so.
Television commercials, and then later you get cast in a film, if you're lucky.
It was flying. It was so real. It was over this giant circuit board or something.
You know, I had a dream that I was naked at school. I had to hide in the bathroom.
I can't really explain why I understand what I understand. I just do. And to try to figure it out, I think, would kind of ruin it, you know. I want to leave it like a mine of gold, you know, without ever mining it, you know, and selling it. I don't want to sell it off. I don't want to talk about it. I don't want to understand it in a way that will exploit the pureness. So I just leave it. I don't understand it, but I believe it.
You're a natural.
I'm not saying anything.
I'm saying it.
Okay, thank you very much.
Yeah. River Phoenix has a kind of vulnerability that you just rarely see in men. Men rarely let themselves experience or definitely don't let themselves show. And that was something, you know, you had an emotional response to the roles that he played, and you felt like they weren't roles, that they were him.
For me, you know, being true is all I can do, you know, and that's all I can do in my craft that makes it valid for me.
How about you, Mr. Manfield? Would you care to venture a guess?
Well, you can't dance to Beethoven.
It's very good, Manfield. Do you listen to much Beethoven?
No, not really.
Well, how did you identify this piece?
I guess I've heard some.
The purity that he kind of embodies as somebody who, you know, can't lie, who has access to intense and complex feelings and can express them in a way that is believable and truthful from areas that may be unpopular.
At one of the press conferences, I heard you make the connection with how America treats their homeless. I thought
Absolutely.
That was interesting.
Well, I mean, we all know it. I mean, there's nothing to hide. It's very obvious. There are priorities that lie more in an arms race or supporting like a World Bank, which has its subsidiaries and its affiliates spreading, you know, develop the third world or whatever, you know, spreading its havoc across our continent, you know. It's more of like a police state now, more so than ever in the States, you know. They're controlling things that get the culture in trouble, you know. It's like a pressure cooker and never turning the stove off. It cooks and cooks until it explodes.
He really was such an inspiration to anyone in their teens and 20s at that time, not to mention adults who worked with him who were so blown away by his talent.
River, I'm so happy to be here talking with you today because we have never met. I only know you through your work. I'm a big fan of yours.
Normally, nice meeting you.
We don't start interviews saying we're a big fan. That's supposed to be a no-no. But you have to know that I am.
He never had the arrogance that a lot of Hollywood people do. He would never assume that anybody knew him or knew who he was or what he did. He would introduce himself to people even though they knew, but he was unaware of that. And he had this sort of hunger for knowledge about people, and it was always curious about what they did and who they were and where they were from.
It's not about career, it's about believing in something, it's about prosperity, and it's about caring and empathizing and wanting to create the best, the most true to life, the most real.
Well, that's something that you wouldn't hear a lot of Hollywood people say.
That's why I don't hang out and talk to those Hollywood people, because they're there to hurt me, they're there to hurt my views.
You're the oldest of five children. You were, I assume you were brought to ecological awareness as a very early, when you were a kid,
yeah.
Huh?
Luckily, yes.
Your parents?
Yes, my parents shared a lot of untold truths to me.
Hello, I'm River Phoenix. If you care about animals, I've got some good news for you.
Hold on.
People for the Ethical Treatment of Animals can help you find easy ways to help out. PETA, that is, can help you out with a lot of things. You can get a lot of information on how to help animals. If I read it, it'll just look like I'm reading. People for the Ethical Treatment of Animals can show you. You're not filming this, are you?
I think River did a lot, especially considering the decade of the 80s, where people were it was a much more selfish generation. People were not so interested in the world around them, but more in making money.
That greed, for lack of a better word, is good. Greed is right. Greed works.
And River brought a brand new approach to using celebrity to speak about issues.
Are you a kid who cares about animals? There are lots of us. Come join us and find out how you can help. Write for a free brochure at PETA Kids, Washington, D.C., 20015. Thank you. Hope to hear from you soon. Right, Jupiter?
We're bombarded from age, whenever you start school, with this sort of propaganda that if you don't eat your milk and your eggs and your chicken and your fish and your meat, then, well, you'll just die and you won't grow up to be big and strong like your grandfather, and that's just not true.
Eat vegetables.
is really great, and there's a great variety, and, you know, we get asked often, well, you don't need animal products, so what do you eat? Just vegetables and roots
and tree bark
and rocks. Yeah, well, there's a lot more, and you find that out when you attend something like this. It's really nice to.
There's a very limited amount of what you can get from an animal to actually eat, but there are millions and millions of different kinds of things that grow from this earth that are edible, and so therefore your limitations are virtually nil.
Expect of anyone else is what I try to do with my time, and I have a lot of good examples. I've met a lot of people in my lifetime who have been very committed to activism and have been very committed to expressing their opinions, you know. And when we have that as an option, which we do as Americans, why don't we take that chance more often? Why don't we, you know, extend ourselves into issues that affect us all? From 3 to 7, I was in South America, Venezuela and Mexico and Puerto Rico. Caracas, Venezuela, Mexico, Florida, Arizona, a number of places. Yeah, it's pretty day to day. It was pretty spontaneous. You know, we didn't have a place to live, so we just kind of went all over the place.
So I've been, you know, very used to that spontaneous, let's pick it up and move on kind of thing.
River always remained philosophical about his family's constant moving around, believing that it would nurture his career as an actor in being able to draw on the many travels he experienced.
Moving around often exposed me to a lot of different lifestyles, different people, different atmospheres. Learning to adapt in these new situations had given me some insight, you know, in new towns and in new places and new schools. You can't, you know, stand out as being, you know, the awkward new boy in town, you know, and the same with, you know, acting. And I guess just, you know, being exposed to a lot of different, you know, characters and people, you know, and having, you know, that experience under my belt has, you know, helped me a lot.
At birth, River was christened River Jude Bottom. The family would change their surname to Phoenix to symbolize rebirth, for in Greek mythology, the phoenix was a bird which obtains new life by arising from the ashes of its predecessor. The media would constantly use this metaphor, along with his first name, in their feature articles about River throughout his entire career.
So what did your parents do during that time?
They were missionaries. They were doing missionary work down there.
It was a very radical religious cult funded by a guy called Reverend David Berg, and the beliefs were that they were very sort of anti-establishment, anti-established religion, and it was very much a sort of a free love-based cult.
And all you have to do is open the door and let him in. All you have to do is pray with me and say, Jesus, please come into my heart. I believe you're the Son of God. I believe you died for me. Please forgive me of my sins and come into my heart. Lord Jesus.
The Lord just gave us all this vision, how we could reach these young people. And we'd seen all these hippie type being sort of beaten up by the police in New York, demonstrating and against the war. And
It just suddenly broke my heart, and I thought, wow, this generation is really lost. We've got to reach them.
Well, you've been searching a long time? Some way to live for it?
Super long time.
This is home. Do you want to give your life with us? Do you want to give your life to the Lord with us?
Yes.
Despite River's lack of formal education, River's intelligence and thoughtful awareness would impress all who met him throughout his life.
And I wholly support education and always would say, you know, education first. But there are always exceptions to that rule, and not everybody needs an education in the traditional way. Some people get an education just by living life.
He was so healthy in so many ways, and yet he wouldn't know certain facts that if a normally educated person, you know, if you run across someone like that, they would know who, you know, Truman was or who some past president. He wouldn't know. Just some odd fact that he just didn't study, but he knew other things.
He was like an adult. It was like talking to another adult. There was a wisdom about him, even at his young age.
So how do you get from missionaries' children to being in the movies? That's a major jump.
Yeah, well, in the missionary group, I learned how to play guitar, and so we were into entertaining.
And then what?
And then we just, like, sang in Westwood a lot, my sister and I, and all the family.
And on the street?
On the streets,
On the street?
Yeah, the cops had to kick us out because the crowds were getting into the street and were causing accidents.
We wore these Western-style costumes and played tambourines and guitars. It was the whole family singing. And I remember that I recalled seeing them in Westwood when I lived down there. It was set up right around the corner from where the Hare Krishnas used to hang out in Westwood.
I came out to Los Angeles to make it. And at the time I was 9 years old and my sister was 7, and we wanted to be recording artists, which was a bit far-fetched, I suppose. We were somewhat amateur. Since we were young, we were novelty and cute and talented. But it was, you know, it just wasn't album material.
So anyway, we got an agent, Iris Burton, who's in the audience.
Oh, I know Iris, yes. She's a nice lady.
Yes, and
and a good agent.
Very good agent.
So how'd you get such a good agent?
Give me this ring.
Oh, let's see. I'll trade you.
River's agent was Iris Burton, a renowned figure in Hollywood with a reputation for her no-nonsense approach, and who would eventually sign the entire Phoenix family to her agency.
And a big family you have.
Yeah, a real big family. By the time I was 9 years old, I got to Los Angeles, and then since then I've basically been living out of Los Angeles.
He grew up with a very interesting family, and they're sort of like hippie family.
They didn't have the Hollywood lifestyle. When they lived in Los Angeles, when I knew them, they lived in Shadow Hills. It was like a suburb, and off there was it was horse country. You know, they still lived their life the way they lived it.
Thank you. In 1982, River would get his first big break in acting when he won the role of Guthrie in the TV series Seven Brides for Seven Brothers. Although the series would only run for 22 episodes, River made an immediate impression. In 1984, River would win the Best Young Actor in a Drama Series for his role at the Young Artist Awards, and he would begin to receive heavy fan mail from newfound fans.
Came in with his little guitar and did an Elvis Presley impersonation for us. It is marvelous.
1, 2, 3, clock, 4, clock, rock, 5, 6, 7, clock, 8 o'clock, rock, 9, 10, 11, clock, 12, clock, rock, we're gonna rock around. The clock too late, put your glad rags on and join me. How are we gonna have some fun? When the clock strikes one, we're gonna rock around the clock too late. Gonna rock, 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 the broad daylight. Gonna rock around the clock tonight. When the clock strikes 12, we'll cool off then. Start a rockin' round the clock again. We're gonna rock around the clock tonight. Gonna rock, rock, rock till broad daylight. Gonna rock around the clock tonight. Gonna rock around the clock tonight. Da 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 da.
The cancellation of the television show did nothing to stall River's career as an actor, as he was quickly signed to play a young boy suffering from dyslexia. The TV movie entitled Backwards, The Riddle of Dyslexia, was known as an after-school special, part of a series of television movies which sought to promote important issues to both children and parents alike. River's brother Joaquin would also star in the movie, and the Phoenix brothers would be nominated for Young Artist Awards.
How about if I tell you a story? And Brian was so big, he could pick up his little bitty one of a brother and throw him in the air so high that when he fell, oh, he felt a big bump. Oh. But this humongous, powerful brother Brian had a secret.
What?
He wouldn't tell anyone what it was.
Why?
Because it's not a secret if you tell anyone.
He'd tell his brother.
No, he wouldn't.
Make it so he told his brother, Brian, what was the secret?
You want to tell the story. All right, go ahead.
No, you tell it. Only tell what the secret was.
This big, gigantic, powerful brother, Brian, was...
What?
A dumbbell.
No, he wasn't. He was real smart. He was smarter than anyone else in the whole world.
I've got some homework to do, Robbie.
Will you finish the story later?
Yeah. Do you know why?
Why?
Because you're such a good kid. Why am I such a dumbbell? Why can't I be like other people?
Sister to torture. Use your imagination. You got a grandmother.
Did you put the term papers where I told you?
Yep, did it last night. They're under the loose floorboard of the vacant apartment across the hall.
Hey, you're executive material, Brian.
Hey.
What's that?
Well, you've been at the gymnastics camp a year this week. There's a celebration here.
Dad, they're crazy.
Yeah. Well, I would have put it in your dessert, except knowing what a strict diet you jocks are on.
Well, Coach says if you really want something bad enough, you gotta be willing to give up some of the sweet things in life.
River's next major TV role would be Surviving, A Family in Crisis, a confronting and honest look at teen suicide and the effects of the families left behind. The film would star teen icon Molly Ringwald and Gremlin star Zach Galligan, who would play the teenagers who take their own lives. River would portray Galligan's younger brother Philip, who was tormented after his brother's suicide. River would be honored as Best Young Actor in a television special at the Young Artist Awards for his stunning performance. Heather O'Rourke, who starred in the hugely successful Steven Spielberg film Poltergeist, would play his younger sister. Tragically, Heather O'Rourke would die in 1988. She was only 12 years of age.
ABC Theater is proud to present a story that finds hope in the aftermath of teenage suicide. Watching it may be the most important thing you and your family can do. Surviving, Sunday at 8, 7 Central.
Yesterday, in this room, he told me. I thought he was kidding. I didn't listen to him. Why did he do it? Why?
I don't know.
He ruined everything. Family. He didn't care about us. He only cared about her. About Lottie.
Lottie.
Shh, baby, shh.
I wish you would have finished the job the first time. I wish you would have never come home.
Philip, wait.
He must have really hated us. Boy, he must have hated us.
During the filming of Surviving, River would be sent the script for a major motion picture named Explorers, a science fiction fantasy. River would say that he got a thrill from just reading the script, and the producers allowed River time off to audition for the film, in which he would land the role as young scientist Wolfgang Müller.
It was about kids who build a spaceship and go to another planet and meet these kids who turn out to be alien children.
Hey, watch what you're doing. Shh, pass me the Phillips head.
Don't like that. You need the ratchet here.
I can't do anything with your hand in the way.
It's stuck. Give me that thing.
Here.
Ouch! Watch.
Shh. Be quiet, man. Bang like that, your mom's gonna wonder what we're doing.
This thing works, everyone's gonna wonder what we're doing. There. I think that's it.
Yeah. Switch on the computer.
Ready? Here goes.
From the director of Gremlins, Explorers, coming this summer from Paramount Pictures. The adventure begins in your own backyard.
The studio changed hands in the middle of production, and they decided that they needed this picture much quicker than we thought. And they said, well, you know, why don't you just stop now? And so we'd shot the picture under very hurried auspices with the paint on the sets was literally wet, and when the kids stepped in the spaceship, they sunk into the cement because it wasn't dry.
Johan, keep your projectiles to yourself.
So there was quite a lot of activity in this town last night. There were numerous UFO sightings. Many of them at the drive-in. As the police are trying to investigate and to discover who destroyed the concession stand.
Wolfgang! What? Your color is not good. You should not be making experiments so late.
River Phoenix, who had done several other pictures, this was his first feature film. He'd done a lot of television, and he was a great guy, but he was exactly the opposite of the character that he plays in the movie. He plays this sort of nerdish computer geek, and he was actually, we originally thought of him for the third kid, the more of this sort of battered child, and then we found another kid who was great for that, and we thought, River's so good, let's have him play this other part. And it was so funny, because he would be on this set of Pebble Woman. And, you know, there were all these girls hanging around, and, you know, teenagers, and he was with his nerdy outfit and his little glasses, and so whenever girls came by, he would take the glasses off. And he was actually sort of like a little Clark Kent. And he was such a great a great kid.
River absolutely captured that, but with there was a vulnerability underneath it too. I know with those kids, there's always a reluctance to invite people into the family, into the household, because it's usually pretty chaotic. And so we tried to capture that in the film. And he certainly, you know, was very protective, very secretive. And a lot of that came through in the character, too.
I'm not sure the bug bomb was down here somewhere. Insect byproducts. Hello.
Oh, so this is a new experiment.
Yeah.
How's it going?
Oh, it's fine.
Well, with all this equipment, isn't that my video sync generator?
Nah, but I seriously doubt it, Father.
Hello, Heinlein. Shut up, Heinlein.
Ah, now that I come to think of it, I did see some insect waste products over in that corner. So, and there could be some bug bomb.
Bug bomb?
Yeah, of course. Most definitely in that corner.
Despite the poor box office and mixed reviews for Explorers, River now had the attention of Hollywood producers, and he would be immediately offered the leading role in the coming-of-age drama, Stand By Me. An adaptation of the story, The Body, written by Stephen King, which featured in his novel Different Seasons. It was his lead performance as the character Chris Chambers that would make River Phoenix a star. In a 1988 interview, River stated the importance of securing the role. It is obvious that River was feeling the pressure to continue to support his family, a serious concern for him.
I liked acting, but I always liked it, but I got real serious about it right after a film called Explorers, and I had been in a motorcycle accident in the dirt field behind where I was racing around, and tore some tendon in my left knee, and was sitting around a lot thinking and getting very serious about life and realizing, you know, how important it was to me. Then I got the Stand By Me audition soon thereafter, and I kind of limped in, which kind of helped me for the part in a way, you know, because I kind of had this kind of tragic, you know, air to me, you know, because I was kind of bummed out about this.
In all our lives, there's a fall from innocence, a time after which we are never the same. It happened in the summer of 1959, a long time ago.
Oh, man, wait till you hear this. Wait till you hear this.
What is it, man?
You guys want to go see a dead body?
When the night has come and the land is dark.
We interrupt to bring you an update on the search for the missing 12-year-old Ray Brower.
Kid's gone. They're never gonna find him.
Not where they're looking.
And the moon is the only light we'll see.
You think Mighty Mouse could beat up Superman?
Mighty Mouse is a cartoon. Superman is a real guy. No way a cartoon could beat up a real guy. We're gonna be famous. We're gonna be on every radio and TV show in the country.
I still don't think we should go.
have one food for the rest of my life? That's easy. Pez. Cherry flavored Pez. No question about it.
And I could go someplace where nobody knows me.
We found him. We got dibs.
We better start running, Eyeball. They got dibs.
The four of us, Eyeball. You just make your move. You're dead.
For some, it's the last real taste of innocence.
I'm never gonna get out of this town, am I, Gordy? You can do anything you want, man.
And the first real taste of life.
This is really a good time. The most. A blast.
But for everyone, it's the time that memories are made of.
So darling, darling, stand by me. Oh, stand by me. Oh, stand. Stand by me. Stand by me.
And it was a real character piece and a character study, and very personal to Stephen King because it was kind of his life.
My memories of boyhood was that it was a riot, that it was a lot of fun, and there's a lot of funny stuff that happened, and I tried to put a lot of that into the story. And Rob tried to put a lot of that into the movie, too.
Hey, how do you know a Frenchman's been in your backyard? I'm French, okay? Your garbage cans are empty and your dog's pregnant. Didn't I just say I was French?
Is it loaded?
Hell no! What do you think I am? Jesus!
Shut up!
I don't shut up.
Shut up, I grow up. And when I look at you, I throw up.
And then your mother goes around the corner and she licks it up.
Oh!
With River Phoenix, there needed to be this kind of wizened peacemaker, this kind of earth person, and that he was. He came from a background, he lived as a hippie, and his parents, you know, lived out of a VW microbus and all of that, and he was a vegetarian, they lived off the land and so on, and he had those qualities.
You knew it was loaded, you wet end! I'm gonna be in trouble now, that Tupper babe saw me.
Shit, Gordy, she thought it was firecrackers.
I don't care, that was a mean trick, Chris.
Hey, Gordy. I didn't know it was loaded. No, I'll kill you, you son of a bitch!
I'm just trying to save your life, man! You want to kill yourself? Is that what you want, goddammit? You're trying to kill yourself!
I don't need no babysitter.
You do too. Skin it.
I could have dodged it.
Listen, Teddy, you can dodge it on the way back, man. Peace. Skin it.
The scene where Chris breaks down at the tree when they're standing guard in the forest at night is my favorite scene in the whole movie. It's the most emotional scene, and it's powerful for a couple of reasons. One is it's beautifully written. It's taken mostly from the book by Stephen King, and it does talk about a time when a child is let down by an adult. I mean, that which is a devastating thing for a child when an adult does something to disappoint you or lie to you or cheat you in some way. That's a terrible blow to a child. When we did that scene, River had to carry that very emotional thing at the end where he breaks down and cries over having been hurt by this teacher in the school. When he did it the first couple of times, he didn't have all the emotion that he needed.
He was very nervous about the scene where he breaks down and tells Gordy about stealing the milk money.
I talked to him about some sense memory, and I said, is there a moment in your life where you can recall an adult letting you down and betraying you in some way? I said, you don't have to tell me what it is. I just want you to think about it, and if there is that moment, maybe you can think about that, and that'll help you in the scene. And he went off, and he thought, and he says, okay, I'm ready to do it. And he did the scene, and as you see, it's beautiful. He breaks down, and he cries.
He was very, very nervous about, being able to pull those tears and be able to make it real and honest and he just delivered.
After the scene was over, I went and I hugged him and I told him I loved him and he gave me a big hug and he felt better. But it took him a while to get over it. Obviously, there was something that was very hurtful to him in his life that he connected with in order to make that scene work.
Upon completion of Stand By Me and prior to the film's release, River would guest star in the phenomenally successful comedy TV series Family Ties, the show which had catapulted Michael J. Fox to fame and which often gave emerging stars such as Tom Hanks, Gina Davis, Martha Plimpton, and many more popular guest star appearances. Both Corey Feldman and Will Wheaton would soon follow in River's footsteps and appear on the show.
Next Family Ties, Alex gets tutored by a 14-year-old genius.
I definitely sense some hostility emanating from you.
But Alex's young tutor just can't seem to concentrate.
Gene, do you mind? I'm paying you by the hour.
What is time? I just met the mother of my children.
When this boy genius falls hopelessly in love, he becomes a very generous suitor.
What is it? An X-ray of my brain.
Family Ties.
Hey, that's a nice one.
Have you read Testrick's paper on the meaning of man's existence in the universe?
Ah, yes. That's heady stuff. Don't you agree, Dumpling?
Oh, I don't know, Muffin Head. The last book I read was Nancy Drew, Mountain Nurse.
Mountain Nurse. Isn't she priceless? Such a fresh sense of humor. Jennifer, you're acting like a child.
Eugene, I am a child.
Oh, you're embarrassing me in front of my peers.
Eugene, listen, I'm sorry. I'm doing the best I can. This is my first 10-year party.
Jennifer, Eugene, are you enjoying yourselves?
Oh, it's fabulous, Walter. A splendid affair.
Yeah, I think it's really neat.
Oh.
What she means is, it's fabulous, Walter. A splendid affair.
No, I don't mean that. Why do you keep correcting everything I say?
Because you're embarrassing me with this infantile behavior.
Eugene, listen, I'm just trying to make conversation.
That's a poor excuse for conversation. It's neat. I haven't heard that since I was teaching high school.
Eugene, take it easy.
No, I won't take it easy. This evening is very important to me, and she's acting so immature, it just makes me mad. I hate it, I hate it, I hate it.
Eugene, listen.
No. I don't want to hear it.
Eugene, please.
No, I can't hear you. I can't hear you.
Eugene! Eugene!
Eugene, wait!
Eugene, come back!
I'm sorry. I made a complete fool out of myself.
That's the first time I've seen that side of you. I liked it.
You liked it?
Well, that's the first time I've seen you act like a kid for once. Eugene, you may be smart, but you're not a grown-up. You know, underneath that brain, you're a really nice boy.
Thank you for looking. And I think that you are an extremely stunning and vivacious. I think you're really neat, too.
Do you want to get a soda?
Yeah, that'll be fun.
Hey, what's going on?
Jennifer and I are going to go get a soda.
Well, I think that's great. I mean, I'm glad you two hit it off. You go out, you have a wonderful time. Eugene, quick. Gottlieb's theorem.
Thank you.
Clearly the film which everyone sort of remembers you from when you were very young was Stand By Me. Right. I mean, can you tell us a little bit about being part of such a classic film like that?
Listen, we just had the 25th anniversary Blu-ray release party where Rob Reiner, who directed Stand By Me, Corey Feldman, who was in it, Will Wheaton, who was in it, and myself all met up, and it was a crazy experience. First of all, I can't believe it's been 25 years. Secondly, I can't believe people are still talking about that movie 25 years later. It just goes to show you how magical it was. And thirdly, it was really sad because River Phoenix has passed away. And just being there and he's not there, it's a weird feeling. It makes it a little surreal. It makes you think, should we even be here? Then you think, yes, we should be here to celebrate it. So there's a mixed bag of emotions there.
River and I had the same kind of aversion to publicity. We just dealt with it in different ways. And River understood, he was wise beyond his years, River understood that a big part of the business of acting and a big part of the business of Hollywood is to kind of embrace that publicity. And he hated it. And he hated the attention. And he hated that people were paying all kinds of attention to actors and were ignoring humanitarian crises all over the world. And he hated that people were making such a big deal out of who he was dating. And nobody cared about poverty in the United States. River just hated that. But he knew that he had to embrace it and had to be part of that to further his career.
You might say that his fame and his success was an adversary to his peace. You know, and that he was being seen, and also knowing that his family came more and more to depend on him because he was the main breadwinner for a clan.
Upsets me, and I'm basically upset at myself for being as naive and gullible as I have been in the past as far as being intimidated by, you know, the stylists with the wardrobe and the hairdos and the poses and the this and that and all this stuff that isn't me. And what it does is it makes you, like, an image, and then they blast you on all these magazines and sensationalize, and you know, they're all very nice and sweet and goody-goody, but still it's just false as far as, you know, the image that it portrays. It's not me.
There's nothing worse than being thrown into the world not knowing your own identity when everybody else already thinks they know who you are, because you can never live up to it. Never.
In 1989, Corey escorted Drew Barrymore to the Oscars. A year later, at age 18, he hit bottom when police arrested him for cocaine and heroin possession. He entered drug rehab and achieved sobriety. Then his friend and Stand By Me co-star River Phoenix died of a cocaine and heroin overdose. He was only 23.
I was literally shocked and terrified at the thought that it could have been me. I had a phone call with him. I let him know that I was sober and I'd been through it. He didn't really want to talk much. And then he made an attempt to kind of reach out to me and left a message on my answering machine. Unfortunately, I wasn't there to receive that call, and we never spoke again.
Following Corey Feldman's arrest in 1990, River would make a statement regarding Feldman's situation. After River's death in 1993, Corey Feldman would state that River was one of the few in Hollywood to actually support him throughout his ordeal.
That ultimately trying to hold those two, hold his ideal and embrace the reality of business got to be too much for him. So when I heard that River had died, I was devastated, like all of us were, because I lost a friend. We hadn't talked for a number of years, but we were extremely close up until I was about 15. And I was devastated because he was gone. We lost a tremendous actor. I knew his entire family and knew that they lost a brother and a son. And it was so preventable, you know?
In 2008, Total Film Magazine released a special issue of the 100 Greatest Movie Characters of All Time, as voted by readers of the magazine. Rivers' role in Stand By Me as the character Chris Chambers would be voted in at number 96. One reader would explain why. Stand By Me made River Phoenix a bona fide star, and his image soon became synonymous with teen magazines around the world. Within a space of less than 3 years, River had become an idol to millions and a pin-up favorite. In doing so, River would compromise for photographers, which would lead him to eventually distrust the very thing that captured his greatest performances, the camera.
Well, I mean, the problem is that I believe very much in the Native American Indians who really owned this land beforehand, and their idea was that a photo can take your soul.
And it scares the shit out of me, too, to be frank.
To be in front of a camera?
Oh, it's so frightening.
Oh.
That's why when I'm on set, I never look at the camera. You don't look at the camera.
That's funny.
I'm very frightened right now.
Although River would secure the role of Charlie Fox in the film adaptation of Paul Theroux's classic novel, The Mosquito Coast, director Peter Weir initially passed on River, believing, despite a strong audition, that River was too old for the part, preferring his Stand By Me co-star, Will Wheaton. Eventually, Weir decided that despite his age, River was ideal for the role, realizing too that River bore a resemblance to Harrison Ford, who played Ali Fox, the father of River's character.
We eat when we're not hungry, we buy what we don't need, and throw away everything that's useful.
There are people in New York that live on pet food and would kill you for a quarter. You don't dare take a walk for fear somebody will stick a knife in your ribs.
Why sell a man what he wants? Sell him what he doesn't need. Pretend he's got 8 legs and 2 stomachs and money to burn. It's wrong.
Some said he was a genius.
Honey, he's gonna love it. I'm gonna knock his socks off. I'm gonna straighten his hair.
But Dad, what is it?
It's perfection. That's what it is.
Some thought it was madness.
Nobody ever thinks of leaving this country. I do.
I think about it every day.
Tell him he is a dangerous man. And one of these days he's gonna get you all killed.
He wanted to change the world.
What is it you want?
Album room.
Come on.
And when the world wouldn't listen.
Goodbye, America! Have a nice day!
He found a world that would.
Can you see it, Mother?
See what, Ali?
Why, a beautiful house right in front of you.
You know, no house.
To a land trapped in the past.
State your business, Reverend.
It's the Lord's business.
The Lord hasn't any idea this place exists.
Came a man with a vision of the future.
What's that part about you?
Your father can do magic.
It's not magic. It's science.
To a savage wilderness.
There's hope here, Mother. There's hope here.
Came a man at odds with himself.
That's why I'm here! That's why I came!
A man who would take those who loved him.
I miss my old home in America.
To the edge of civilization.
I think something's going to happen.
Oh my God!
Why are you doing this to us?
We cannot go back.
And beyond. Harrison Ford in his most remarkable performance.
All your work? So sorry.
I'm happy. We're free.
The Mosquito Coast.
My father was an inventor. A genius with anything mechanical. 9 patents, 6 pending. He dropped out of Harvard to get an education, he said. I grew up with the belief that the world belonged to him and that everything he said was true.
Look around you. How did America get this way? Land of promise, land of opportunity. Give us the wretched refuse of your teeming shores. Have a Coke. Watch TV.
Have a nice day.
Go on welfare. Get free money. Turn to crime. Crime pays in this country.
Tell me about Harrison Ford. Was he fun?
Yeah, he was.
Yeah.
He was.
It was like we were always in character in a way. He was like always my father. He was like my father in a way while we were down there because we were together so much.
Tell us a little bit about Mosquito Coast, then we can show the clip.
Okay, Mosquito Coast.
What's the basic story?
Well, it's not Robinson Crusoe. It sounds like it, but it's not. It's about this father who takes his family because he can't stand the system.
Can you see the town yet, Ali?
Yes. Yes. Perfect. It's perfect. Everything we need is here. Right here. Oh, yes, yes.
Starting from scratch.
Oh, Ali.
Do you see it, Charlie?
No, Dad. And then, of course, everything just falls apart like it should in most movies.
Right.
Give them every chance to leave. If they just lay down, they'll be all right. They won't feel a thing. In a few moments, they'll be frozen solid.
Do you have a normal life of any kind? Do you have a girlfriend?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Girlfriend.
Yeah. So who's the girlfriend? Who's the girlfriend? You can tell me, Rio. Oh, they're not listening. They're busy watching. Glitter, glitter, glitter.
Where's the clip?
We'll put the clip on. Don't worry.
Okay.
Look how showbiz you are. Where's the clip?
Well, I figured that could answer your question a little.
Hi. Charlie, do you have a girlfriend?
No.
I could be your girlfriend, if you want.
I think about you when I go to the bathroom.
Who is the girl? Who's the girl?
That was played by Martha Plimpton.
She's very good, Martha
Plimpton. She is, yeah.
I've known Martha since Mosquito Coast. You know, we get on really good, and she's, you know, we have a lot of the same beliefs and stuff. So as far as feeling comfortable, it was fine.
Brazilian singer Milton Nascimento wrote the song River Phoenix, Letter to a Young Actor, inspired after having seen River in the Mosquito Coast. The song would appear on Nascimento's 1989 album release, Milton.
Eu falei, meu Deus do céu, isso não é um ator, isso é um espírito, é uma coisa, é muito forte.
How am I doing, son?
Fine, Dad.
I can't move, just my head.
You'll get better.
Man sprang from a faulty world, Charlie. It's a bad design, the human body. The skin's not thick enough. Too little hair, no claws or fangs. We weren't meant to stand upright. Exposes our heart and genitals. Should be on all fours. Hairier. With tails. Look at me. I'm gonna be on all fours from now on.
I don't want Dad to die.
I know that. I know.
Nature's crooked. I wanted right angles. Straight lines. You cut yourself opening a can of tuna and you die.
Se um dia
pra desvendar os olhos teus. E se a gente se falar, contar as coisas que viveu, o que esperamos do amanhã, será que pode acontecer? Pois paralelo ao personagem, eu quis saber mesmo é de ti. Queria que fosses feliz, uma água calma inundar a sua margem de carinho, peito aberto a quem chegar, como teu nome diferente, uma paisagem nos induz, uma paisagem de inocência, mas que se sabe e que conduz. Agora este momento, o pensamento e os olhos meus brilhando de emoção e grato. Alguém que só te conheceu num filme que viu tantas vezes, que este poema
River's father John had acted as chaperone for River whilst filming on location in Belize. Director Peter Weir noticed a conflicted relationship. As River's star continued to rise in Hollywood, John Phoenix would become more estranged from wife Arlen and her Hollywood ambitions and his son's success. Former girlfriends Sue Solgott and Martha Plimpton would recall that in later years, River would try various methods of trying to bond with his father, who River greatly admired and respected. Realizing his father's growing disillusionment with the Phoenix family's success, River would later buy a Costa Rica property for Joe. Despite strong critical praise for the film, The Mosquito Coast would not be a success at the box office. But this did nothing to dampen River's memories of the film, in which he stated the role remained close to his heart, albeit for many different reasons. River's final TV performance would be the role of Chris Benfield in the TV drama Circle of Violence, a probing look at domestic violence against the elderly, with actress Tuesday Weld playing River's domineering mother. River would later state that he had to deliver the worst line of dialogue in his career.
Something you don't know anything about. She has always been irresponsible. And people have made allowances for her all her life because she was pretty, because she was cute, because she could sing a little bit. Well, her life is different now. Lou is not here to baby her anymore.
Mom, would you cool it? She can hear you.
You don't know what your grandmother is like. You think she's an angel. Well, she's not. She is a manipulative, demanding, terrible old lady. Why do you suppose your Uncle David has cut himself off completely, huh? Mother? Chris, will you just go see what she's doing? Well, now that she's made this big banquet,
Mom!
I suppose we ought to eat it.
Mom! What's she's it? Running away. Grandma's leaving in the rain.
Well, where is she?
She went out the back door with a bag.
Which way did she go?
Towards Woodman.
Oh.
Mom, should we go with you?
No, you stay here.
Following Circle of Violence, River would film three motion pictures back-to-back that would eventually be released together in 1988. The first would be A Night in the Life of Jimmy Reardon.
Don't be afraid to ask why.